David Fincher's new movie was one of my highly anticipated movies of 2023, and I am glad to say that it absolutely delivered. From frame one, Fincher's fingerprints are all over the picture. It's a highly subjective film, and I love that about it. It's highly reminiscent of a lot of Scorsese's work, with the excessive but poignant use of voiceover that puts you in the headspace of the character. The killer doesn't even have a name, not that we know of, but we learn so much about him and his thought process through the voiceover. It's so subjective that we even see his thoughts get interrupted when someone else speaks or when something else happens that breaks his concentration. This isn't someone who talks a lot. Most of what we see is what he sees. He's a silent observer, patient. That's what he mentions in his monologue about just how exhausting boredom can be, but that's part of the job. Fincher's style is ever-present, for the most part. His clean-cut, precise camera movements that capture even the tiniest of behaviors is a delight to see, but it was honestly surprising to see this much handheld camera movements in a Fincher movie. But it mostly works because Fincher conditions us to his clear-cut style so that when he temporarily breaks away from it, subconsciously, we know that this is important. There has been a shift in the dynamics of the scene. When the killer makes a mistake and is fleeing the scene, that whole sequence is shaky and unstable to make us feel the uncertainty and fear that the killer is feeling at that moment. But despite that, there were times where it felt like there was a digital shake added in post to replicate the effect of a handheld camera. That did not entirely work for me. There was a sense of artificiality to it that briefly took me out of the immersion that the film had so brilliantly built. This film looks beautiful. The cinematography bathes the killer in the shadows, giving the film this eerie atmosphere that's perfect for this genre and tone. And Trent Reznor and Atticus Ross's score also never disappoints in accentuating that very eeriness. Michael Fassbender is absolutely phenomenal as the killer. He really disappears into the character and is extremely interesting to watch. The way he thinks and moves is all calculated and thought out. We're introduced to him as this cold and heartless killer who lives by a set of rules that he keeps repeating to himself.
Stick to your plan. Trust no one. Forbid empathy. Anticipate. Don't improvise.
His methods are logistical and methodical, but what makes him fascinating is that there are glimpses of humanity we see within him. There is just some level of empathy that he feels, and that made me ask questions about whether he just lies to himself or whether he really is the ruthless machine he says he is. There's also a sense of pragmatism that could just be disguised self-deprecation. He knows he's not perfect. He says he's not a genius at one point during the film, but he's disciplined. He's a walking contradiction as he goes against whatever he says throughout the running minutes of the movie, but that's exactly what makes him interesting. The film shows us just enough about him, but never too much. The mystery remains, and that left me trying to analyze and figure him out, and that made him endlessly fascinating to watch. We know what he's capable of. We see him mercilessly kill people, and so Fincher uses that to his advantage to draw out the runtime of multiple scenes to create tension. We think he's going to kill because we have seen him do it, but because the scene is going on for so long, we begin wondering whether if it's actually going to happen. Even the violence isn't treated as spectacle. The film can get bloody, but there is no pleasure being taken during this act. The killings are silent, the gunshot is barely audible, and nobody screams in pain. It's mundane, it's no different than a chore, it's just work. The beauty of the film is that it's devoted to the process. What movies usually turns to montages, the killer makes the entire film. It's us following the protagonist do these little tiny things that are part of the process of his ultimate goal. It's the part that we don't really see in these type of movies. The part that's usually skipped over or sped up for the sake of a quick pace. And that to me is a really interesting concept. However, that's also what made the film a little tough to sit through at times. I wouldn't go as far as to call it a meandering bore, but I do wish that I was more invested in it than I actually was. I did not connect to any character other than the protagonist, primarily because everyone else we see who isn't the killer is shown only once. There's no time for me to process or connect to anything, therefore hindering any emotional investment I could have had. Now, Fincher isn't really known for being an emotional filmmaker. There's a level of emotional distance in his films, but even in his other movies, I did find myself to be at least engaged with the story and characters. But with The Killer, I found it a little more tough to be. I did find myself wondering whether this even was a criticism for the film, because the killer's job is such that he doesn't meet people often. He's a social recluse with very little emotional attachments. Anyone else he meets is probably a target, so it makes sense why we never see them again. So are the criticisms I stated even valid for the film? Honestly speaking, I don't know, but I think it's a triumph for the film to get me to ask questions like these. The slow pace still works for the film at times. The opening scene starts off with the promise of a bang, but surprisingly, the scene drags on for way too long, but that's the point. We're supposed to feel the mundanity and exhaustion of boredom that the killer feels. His subjectivity continues with the film's excellent sound design, where the film intercuts between the killer listening to the Smiths to an objective shot where we barely even hear the music, as if we are outside his perspective. I really wish that I'd gotten to see this movie in theaters for the first time instead of on Netflix. My worry for the film is that Netflix might treat this film as just content and just mindlessly dump it on the platform instead of making the effort to promote it, because I think this is definitely a film that you should watch. The killer isn't perfect. Maybe I'm a little disappointed because I was hoping for it to be, especially considering it's made by one of the finest filmmakers working today. But it's an incredibly well-made, low-stakes genre experiment that I am glad I got to see. Thank you guys for watching. This was a shorter video than usual, but thank you for making it here. Like, share, subscribe, please support the channel. It really means the world to me. And until next time, I will see you in the next video. Bye-bye.